Hello everybody, let's continue with our lecture series on this optimal control guidance and estimation course. So, last two lectures we have seen some of this advanced concept or recently developed concept rather, which we call as model predictive static programming, and followed by its usage in various aerospace guidance applications. So, we will continue that line of thought in this lecture as well. And probably give some of these extensions ideas on top of this basic idea basically. So, here we will talk about something called model predictive spread control, very close to static programming, but we will also see a slightly different version, parameterized version and all that. And also we will see this something very recent development rather as of today, something called generalized MPSP. That means, we do not want to deal in discrete domain, but we want to develop this entire procedure in the continuous time domain, where discrete time thing turns out to be kind of a special case actually. So, all right. So, let us get going. The outline of this particular lecture is a little bit on motivation, followed by this MPSC design, what we call model predictive static control, okay, you can or spread control basically, okay, model predictive spread control design. Followed by this, I mean this will within this framework we will talk about mathematical development and that alignment angle constraint mid course guidance of a tactical missile. That will be followed by this generalized MPSP design, again mathematical development followed by another tactical missile guidance application with 3D impact angle constraint, essentially the same application that we discussed in the last lecture basically. But it will be solved in the GMPSP procedure, that is how. Then we will have some concluding remarks and wind it up basically. So, let us see this. First thing is model predictive spread control or parameterized MPSP, you can think about that way also basically. Okay. All right. So, let us see what is the motivations here. First thing is high computational efficiency. We do not want to compromise that particular aspect of MPSP actually. So, we want to retain that. In fact, you are asking one more question, that can it be still better than MPSP? Okay, so, is it possible still? Second is again the same thing, terminal constraints will be met as hard constraint, and especially in missile guidance problem this leads to very high accuracy basically. Okay, and no approximation of system dynamics. And then minimum control usage, these are all similar to MPSP what you have seen before. And in addition to that, we are telling can the computational efficiency be slightly better, and the last one we are talking is can control smoothness be guaranteed by enforcement. Okay. It should not be kind of a luck, but by enforcement we should be able to guarantee that basically. So, is it possible to do that? Let us see, this is how we propose to do this. See, MPSP design, what happened is we had a system dynamics, something like x dot is f of x u and y is h of x, and we discretized it to this form, x of k plus 1 is f k of x k u k, and then y k is h of x k. That is the first thing to do there. Then the objective is y n should go to y n star with some additional optimal objective sort of thing. So, in the process of analysis, what you have told is, okay, this delta y n should go to 0, y n minus y n star, but how, what is the philosophy of design? We have to guess a control history and then simulate the system dynamics. You compute the error in the output at the final time, okay, and then update the control history optimally utilizing this error information. Iterate the control history until convergence. That is what the basic philosophy of MPSP design was actually. So, in the process of analysis, we told, okay, this is our error and we approximate the small error approximation sort of thing, and then this dyn can be expanded that way, where dxn can be expanded in the in terms of previous state and previous control. Previous control we keep it, but previous state we expand in terms of another previous state and previous control, things like that. And ultimately, we will end up with this kind of a expression for dyn. And then define this coefficient as something like sensitivity matrices, and these sensitivity matrices can be computed recursively. And we also told that, okay, initial condition is known precisely, so this error in the initial condition should turn out to be 0 basically. I mean, and then what we really get is some linear expression, something like this. That was okay. After this, the idea was to minimize the control history everywhere, and in other words, to minimize some sort of a quadratic performance index actually, in terms of these errors in control essentially. But here we'll depart a little bit in this design and tell, okay, that is that form is okay, but can we really think of something like a parameterized version of the control? To begin with, let's talk about something like a linear parameterization. In other words, we tell that the previous control history, including the gas control, is in the form of linear expression in terms of time to go. Okay. So the T go or TF my, okay, by definition, okay, something like we know T go is nothing but TF minus T, whatever current time is actually. So you can parameterize with respect to T also, no harm. Okay, but typically in guidance problems, we parameterize with respect to T go basically. That is compatible with guidance literature basically. Anyway, so this is a linear expression in terms of T go, and this is also the updated control has to be a linear approximation in terms of T go as well. However, what happens is here the parameters are A naught and V naught. That's like a linear straight line equation sort of thing. And here it is A and V. So the idea here is how do we compute A and V given the fact that we know A 0 and V 0 basically. So now knowing this UK 0 and UK, we define this DUK as something like what we did before. However, this particular expression, okay, can be once we substitute this expression here and here, okay, you substitute UK naught with this guy and UK with this expression, then it turns out that DUK can be approximated as delta A times T go K plus delta B. Okay. Where delta A and delta B are defined as these errors actually. Now, what you see here, the entire expression of control, okay, DUK, is expressed in terms of delta A and delta B, no matter what value of K is actually. So, for various values of K, the T go K will change, but delta A and delta B will remain same. And taking advantage of that, when you go back to this expression here, we write this expression again, okay, will turn out to be something like this. Okay, you substitute all this expression what you get here and it turns out to be something like this. Okay. So, what you define, so this entire thing can be defined as something like CY and the entire thing can be defined as DY, then it turns out that DYN can be expressed as some sort of a linear combination of delta N delta V. Okay. So, the whole idea here is the entire flexibility boils down to only in terms of delta and delta v. In other words, we can simply update this a and v coefficients and we are done actually. So, the number of free variables in this particular case reduces to only 2. Okay. That is because we have actually parameterized in terms of linear expression, and linear expressions typically, I mean straight line expressions to be very exact. So, the straight line expressions can have only 2 flexible parameters actually. So, because of that, this DYN has become a function of only delta A and delta B. And as we know, this sensitivity matrices can always be computed recursively, that you can see some previous lectures to how do you do that and all that. Alright, the point is it is now a linear expression in terms of delta A and delta B. Now, what happens here is we formulate this optimization problem now, telling that, okay, the optimize this quadratic cost function, okay, subject to this expression what you have got, just simply got it here actually. DYN is CY times delta A plus DY times delta B, but you can always substitute what is delta A and what is delta B and solve it in terms of A and B basically. So, if you just substitute that and then rewrite this same expression, turns out to be this expression actually. Okay. So, what you are telling here is we optimize this cost function subject to this linear constraint actually. Now, what is the idea behind optimizing this quadratic cost function? In other words, we are interested in a solution with A and B both being minimum actually. Now, if you go to a straight line, expression, what do they mean basically? Now, if you see this expression, it is something like A and B will represent something like y intercept and slope actually. Okay. Right. So, if you if you go back to this expression, this A naught and V naught and A and V what you see here, okay, will represent A is nothing but this slope in terms of t go, and V is nothing but the y intercept actually. Okay. So, if you plot this as function of t go, this is nothing but A, okay, is a slope and B is the y intercept sort of thing actually. Okay. So, by demanding that the slope should be minimum and y intercept should be minimum, what you are telling is, okay, it should be almost like a constant function, not necessarily a constant unless A is exactly 0, but subject to the optimization procedure here. Okay. If A is very small or close to 0 rather, then the control profile that you are interested in is almost constant. And because B is also 0, what you are telling is the constant value is almost close to 0 basically. Okay. So, the value of the constant should also become close to 0. So, that is the whole idea of why we want to kind of minimize this cost function actually. Again, how much you want to play with the slope and how much you want to play with the intercept, it all depends on the values of R1 and R2. Okay. If you select both to be same, then you are giving equal importance. Otherwise, if you one is relatively higher than the other, then the importance of that particular expression becomes higher actually. In other words, if R1 is higher compared to R2, then the solution will tell that A becomes smaller than V actually. Okay. All these things you have discussed in LQR class also basically. Anyway, so coming back, this is the objective. To optimize or minimize this cost function subject to this linear constraint. Obviously, it is a static optimization problem again, and it is a very simpler problem actually. Okay. So, the solution of that again you have to formulate a j bar and then take derivative of j bar with respect to A. For del j bar by del A equal to 0 and del j bar by del B equal to 0 and del j bar by del lambda also equal to 0. Okay. Then you will turn out to the solution turns out to be something like this actually. Okay. A and B will turn out to be like this, where lambda can be computed that way. So, again in other words, you got a solution, okay, in terms of a static lambda again, and the solution turns out to be only two variables actually. Okay. No matter how long is the control history and things like that, the solution turns out to be just two. So, it in a way it also addresses the problem of this this curse of dimensionality in some sense, because it now does not depend on what is the length of your control application time. So, even if your control application time turns out to be high or the number of grid points are high, then actually it does not matter, it is immaterial of that actually. Okay. So, in that sense it kind of addresses that problem as well. Anyway, so this is what it is. Now, remember this optimization can be done only when the dimension of this equation turns out to be smaller than the dimension of A and B, AB vector together. That means, the dimension of this constraint equation turns out to be smaller than 2. Okay. In other words, the objective is just 1 actually. Okay. So, if you talk about kind of a Mitchell gradients problem, if you talk about only mixed distance sort of thing, then this is perfect actually. Otherwise, what happens is the constraint, if the constraint turns out to be of equal dimension, that means number of variables are same as number of constraint, then you simply solve it. In other words, there is no flexibility of optimizing A and B basically, and that is obvious. Okay. Now, coming to this, control parameterization, suppose somebody does not want this linear parameterization or it turns out to be very restrictive. It does not give you a solution and things like that. So, the time to think about something like a little more general. So, this turns out to be a quadratic function in terms of t or t go, either way that choice is up to us actually. So, there we do it with respect to t go, and somebody can always think about, okay, I do not want it, I will parameterize with respect to simply t. Okay. So, it turns out to be uk is a function of t, okay, it is a t square plus btk plus c sort of thing. This is a quadratic expression now. And uk is again this control update has to happen this way. So, duk is by definition this two fellows, and hence it is again you can do this, and all the time nicely it turns out that the error in parameters turns out to be linear actually. The coefficients, if you look at it, it turns out to be some sort of something like a linear expression basically. So, again you go back to this expression and turn, okay, this can be done that way, okay. And then what you substitute all that expression to get something similar to what you have done before. Now the parameters or the free parameters rather are in terms of A, B and C. So the equation again can write it as some sort of a linear expression in terms of parameter variables, something like this: C y, D y, E y, B lambda and D y, and all that you can define properly. And then tell, okay, this equation turns out to be some sort of a equation of a, well, equation of a plane actually in 3D now. Okay, so you have three variables only to solve for. Again, no matter how, whatever is the control application length, you can we restrict it in terms of parameters A, B, C basically. Alright, so now what happens here is we go back to this and then tell, okay, what is the cost function to optimize again. Assume that this the dimension of this is equal to dimension of the number of equations, then there is no optimization. You can directly solve it something like this. It turns out to be this. This will turn out to be a square matrix in that case. Okay, the same equation what you get here is written in terms of vector matrix thing here, and it turns out to be a square matrix provided the number of equations are 3 A, B, C. And then in that case you can solve it, okay, in terms of this directly in terms of in matrix inversion and all that. Remember, this has to be a 3 by 3 matrix. So, the matrix inversion is not computationally intensive either actually. The dimension of that will depend on again the number of free variables you are talking in terms of parameters actually. Okay. Now, if it is not equal, in other words the number of unknowns is greater than the number of equations, then there is a scope for optimization. And again, motivated by our previous discussion, we can think of optimizing this cost function subject to this constraint equation actually. So, again the idea of this cost function is if you take a quadratic quadratic variable, okay, it turns out to be something like a quadratic variable like this, then the C again represents y intercept. This, remember, this is T, this is whatever control, and it is a quadratic parameterization. So, C represents the y intercept, B represents the slope, A represents the curvature, things like that. So, again by optimizing this, what you are telling is curvature has to be minimum, slope has to be minimum, and y intercept has to be minimum. Now, again we are interested in some sort of a constant control history throughout, okay, which will give us the result, what we are desired for, even though it is mathematically speaking it is going to be quadratic actually. But what you are interested is somewhat close to constant actually. That is what we are telling by optimizing this actually. Okay. Alright, so this is the idea behind this parameterized version of MPSP. Okay, or you can, we name that as MPSC, and somebody can always tell it as parameterized MPSP actually. Anyway, so this is what it is. The algorithm sense, it is the same, very, very similar to what we have done before. The only difference is we have to guess a control history in terms of control parameterization. In other words, the initial guess itself has to be in the form of same parameterization. Suppose we start with straight line parameterization, then the guess also needs to be straight line. Quadratic parameterization means guess is also quadratic like that. Then propagate the system dynamics, compute the output, check convergence. If it is converged already, take it and stop it actually. Otherwise, you compute the sensitivity matrices, same thing as what you have done in MPSP, but then update the control history using parameter updates actually. Okay. Using the sensitivity matrices, you compute the updated parameters and then proceed further actually. This is the only difference here. Okay. Now, MPSC design, if you think about why it is computational efficiency and all, it turns out to be very similar. The ideas are very similar to MPSP, so hence the regions are also very similar actually. And on top of that, we also get a little better computational efficiency, because in terms of number of free variables, we are reducing the dimension quite a lot actually. In MPSP, we had all sort of number of grid points multiplied by dimension of the control vector. That many free variables were there. Now, here it turns out to be, okay, number of control into number of free parameterization for each dimension or each element of the control vector. So, if you have, let us say, two control and you have got about quadratic parameterization, that means u1 is a quadratic function and u2 is also a quadratic function, then the total number of free variables is 2 into 3, so that is 6 actually. So, it kind of makes it completely independent of number of grid points, and hence it is independent of I mean, this it, in a limited sense, it addresses the issue of this recursive dimensionality. However, also remember that we also need to compute the sensitivity matrices, and that is a function of number of grid points. Okay, so we really don't get rid of recursive dimensionality in that sense, but to some extent it addresses that issue basically. Okay. All right. Now moving on, we'll see some application of this, and this problem turns out to be a angle constraint mid-course guidance using this technique actually. So the objective here is the interceptor must have sufficient capability and proper initial condition for terminal guidance phase, and mid-course guidance. Okay. Now the whole idea here is, I think I've talked about that before as well. Okay. So let me talk a little bit here. So, if you got a target which is coming or running away, whatever it is, you launch a missile, it goes there, and finally the idea is to go and somewhere it has to engage actually. So, this is the target. Now, this entire phase of guidance can be divided into three segments. Okay, one is this is launch phase. Okay, or boost phase sometimes called, and this is terminal phase. The last phase of the engagement, and the large part turns out to be just a mid-course guidance actually. Okay. So, that is where a large part of the trajectory of the missile lies, and this is the problem that you are talking about here actually. Okay. All right. So, that is the okay. So, interceptor spends most of its time during mid-course phase and hence should be energy efficient, that is more important actually. However, what you are telling here is, see, finally it has to go and engage with the target. So, ultimately the terminal phase dictates what is your miss distance, angle constraint and things like that. So, to have a proper initial condition for the terminal phase, we also need some sort of a angle constraint at the end of the mid-course guidance phase actually. And that is what the problem is actually. The interceptor has to reach the desired point. Okay, that xd, yd, zd will be given to it, okay, with desired heading angle phi d and desired flight path angle also gamma d basically. And that should happen using this minimum acceleration or minimum normal acceleration actually, which is n phi and n y sort of thing. So, this is the problem that we are talking here. Okay, this is if you visualize this problem that way, this is the three dimensional plane where this dynamics is given like this x dot, y dot, z dot, something like v cosine gamma, which is this component times cos phi, this is your x dot component. Similarly, v cos gamma sin phi is your y dot component, and v sin gamma is your z dot component. And then you have phi dot and gamma dot also, how they change it, phi dot and gamma dot, they can be derived something like this actually. Okay. Now, the whole idea here is, how do I come up with this norm, this accelerations n phi and n gamma, so that I will achieve the objective basically. And here the little bit idea was, okay, see the, remember our MPSP or MPSP what MPSC, the demand final time actually. Okay, so the final time typically is not known, because again it depends on the trajectory to be followed, and it depends on the accelerations that we apply n phi and n gamma. The point is we don't know it a priori actually. Okay, so how do you get it there? But the whole idea here is, suppose we want to go to a point something like x naught, y naught, z naught. That's what the point is, right? X d, y d, z d. That's what we want to go there. So that particular point, if you think about in this plane, okay, the typical guidance phase happens in terms of something called down range and cross range. That means if the target is somewhere in this direction, okay, the velocity turns out to be like that, it will go somewhere in that direction. So this one is something like a downrange plane, okay, and then anything happens perpendicular to that happens to be crossrange plane actually. So what you are assuming here is x is the kind of a downrange plane, okay, that's how that x system is defined. Okay. X is the downrange plane, and y and z whatever happens in that happens to be the crossrange plane sort of thing. So, what you are assuming here is the downrange is monotonic, okay, and hence we can rewrite this equation in terms of these variables actually. So, this is dt by dx, this is dy by dx, this is dz by dx sort of thing. So, in other words, taking x as a free variable, we rewrite this equation, because ultimately we know the value of this xd. Okay. Now, when x goes to xd and x being a monotonic variable, it will go to xt, because xt is greater than x naught obviously. Okay, so when x goes to xd, the problem formulation demands that y should go to yd, z should go to zd, phi should go to phi d, and gamma should go to gamma d actually. This, okay, when x go to xd, all other things, y should go to yd, z should go to zd, and phi and gamma should go to their corresponding values. Note that we are not putting any restriction on v, because we are, our aim is not to control v. In other words, the final impact velocity can be anything, we are not so much bothered about it. And this is not really an impact velocity, because we are talking about end of mid course guidance, it is not end of terminal phase. The idea here is, typically if you see mid course guidance literature, how do you maximize this VF, that is also important, because ultimately you want to have the either range enhancement or you talk about impact velocity being high. But here we are not talking about that. What you are interested in is we want to guide the vehicle to a particular desired point. And at that desired point, the phi and gamma should also have some desired values basically. Okay. So, that's the problem. All right. So, this is the system dynamics. Now, these are the control variables. So, we followed this, let us say we do that in terms of quadratic parameterization. Remember, the free variable is not t, but x actually here, the down range. So, in terms of down range, we parameterize n phi and n gamma, and then the error function turns out to be like this, y z phi n gamma. And then you apply your MPSC results, whatever we have seen before actually, this kind of logic. And initial value of, initial value of this parameter values, A1, B1, C1, A2, B2, C2, they were found using this augmented PN guidance, which does not talk about angle constraint, but it will take you there basically. Okay. The position constraint will be met, angle constraint will not be met. So, you generate a control history like that. And using least square fit, you can do this initialization of A1, B1, C1 and A2, B2, CT. So, from there you start and then update this coefficient values using this algorithm. So, then the result sense, you can see this kind of thing, you have this position and this x, y, z. So, this is your initial condition, okay. This is our initial condition, and finally, we have to go there. Okay. For case 1, you have to go there, and case 2 also the position remains same, but angle is different actually. For case 1, we want this angle, case 2, we want that angle actually. And you can see very quickly how it is able to go there. You see the error values, it was something using this PN guidance, the error was something very high sort of thing. Even then, the correction of the error is very quick, only 4 iterations, you can see the reduction of the miss actually, reduction of the separation distance basically. Okay. So, 3 kilometer or almost like 4 kilometer separation, it reduces to something like 1 meter and 2 meter sort of thing actually. I mean, so 1 meter, 3 meter like that. So, that is the position part of it. What about the angle? And angle also is 42, starting from 42 degrees, 20 degrees and all, it is very quickly, it is able to give us very small errors in the desired value. This phi f minus phi d turns out to be the errors actually, what you get. Okay, so no matter whether it is case 1 or case 2, it is able to, no matter the case 1 or case 2, what we are seeing here is for case 1 anyway, is able to reduce very quickly actually, okay, just 4 iterations, that is all. Okay, so this is also you can see this how this iterations proceed from trajectory to trajectory. Initially it was something like this, and first iteration, second iteration, third and fourth are almost off of each other actually. So, that is the final desired value. Similarly, on z, first iteration, this is your guess, and the first, this is iteration 1, 2 and 3, 4 basically. So, like that actually, you see all the variables, how they converge and converge quickly also. Now, the angle value, it was going somewhere that way, first iteration, second iteration, third and fourth, it is there on what you want actually, like that. So, this is for case 2, and if you see how it improves with iteration, again you can see that from starting from 3.4 kilometer and again almost like 4 kilometer separation distance reduces to something like half a meter and some 6-7 meters, which is not terminal phase, so we are not talking about missed distance, but whatever is the desired distance with very close to that, whatever the desired point, we are going very close to that. And then at that point, the angle constraints are also getting met very good. Starting from 12.5 degrees and almost like 39 degrees, we are able to reduce it to very small values actually. In fact, if somebody wants, he can continue one or two more iterations, and these values will be even better actually. But we thought of, looking at practical aspects, there is no point of in doing too much actually. All right, so that is what it is. Again, similarly, you can see case 2, okay, it reduces first iteration, second and third, second, third and fourth are here. Really, first iteration, second, third and fourth are here. Like that actually, it proceeds all everywhere. All right. Also, somebody can think about what is this MPQC. Okay. Sometimes we thought of like, okay, we'll define it as model priority quadratic control, because this is all in terms of quadratic parameterization basically. So it's all various names basically. All right. So then we thought of, okay, we'll validate it using six-stop simulation and all, like the 6-degree of freedom model, using a control in the loop and things like that. And also see that even if you put a autopilot loop or control synthesis loop using full 6-degree of freedom nonlinear equations and all that, and the inner loops are designed based on the dynamic inversion ideas actually. So there also you can see that this guidance is able to do the job basically. Ultimately, what you see is something like this actually. And in this case, you have actually closed the loop. In other words, terminal phase is also there. Then what actually? So you can see this trajectory sends these two trajectories gives us the picture, z and y direction, and z direction sort of thing actually. Okay, you can see that the missile goes and engages with the target actually. Okay, and these are some of these results with the 6-DOF control in action actually. So let me not go through the details. But you can also see that how even with 6-DOF simulation, you see that your final error is very close to 0, and final error in Z is also just very close to almost on 0, and final phi and gamma are also 0. That means with the validation here, the level of validation is 1 degree higher, much more higher than this. In the guidance validation, if you do, that's fine. But many times it is required that you also put control in the loop and then verify whether things are right or not actually. Okay. And for the reference, if you really interested to know more about this particular problem, I encourage you to read this paper. It is well documented there. It's a good journal paper with something like 17 pages of write up, so you can see many things out there basically. Okay. All right. Now let's move quickly to what we talk about, the second extension. Okay. Again, it's a very recent development as of now. So this is where we talk about generalized MPSV. Okay. The whole idea here is we want to develop it in continuous time domain actually. Okay. So we don't want to discretize the system dynamics to begin with really. So again, motivations are very similar. We want high computational efficiency. So, real-time online solution, that's what you are interested in. Terminal conditions should be met as hard constraint, no approximation of system dynamics, minimum control usage. And the last point is, we want it without discretization. The first question is, can the discretized problem formulation be avoided basically? Okay. The answer turns out to be yes, and let's see how it is actually. Alright, so you have a system dynamics, x dot is f of x u and y is h of x, where x is an n-dimensional problem, n-dimensional vector, u is m-dimensional vector and y is p-dimensional vector, standard. And we also think that, okay, y of tf should go to y star of tf, okay, that with some additional objectives. Okay, and that is typically the control minimization objective basically. So, the objective remains exactly same. But we are not interested in discretizing the system dynamics to begin with. That's the whole idea here. So what is our final thing? Final thing is this error. In other words, y of tf minus y star of tf should go to 0. Philosophy is also same. First we have to guess a control history. We have to simulate the system dynamics to find out the error at t equal to tf, and then update the control history optimally utilizing this error. So the philosophy remains very, very parallel actually. Alright, so now let us see how we do that. So what we do is, okay, to begin with, we know this system dynamics, okay, and this system dynamics, we multiply it with some sort of a weighting matrix actually, okay, and time varying weighting matrix, okay, we multiply it to make the system dimension same as the output vector, Okay. In other words, after multiplying this both sides, the dimension, the system dynamics that you are looking at is something like in the P dimension actually, and P is nothing but the output variable dimension actually. Okay. Ultimately, you want to see the error in Y. So, that is the whole idea of Y you want to do actually. So, we multiply both sides by W of T. W is something like a P by N matrix, and so that the dynamics what you see is in terms of P dimensions, not in N dimension actually. And how do you come up with this W of T? That is the whole whole idea here. How do we want to kind of propose an idea using which we can actually compute this W of T. Okay. Alright, now what you do is integrate both sides, take this equation and try to integrate both sides actually. Okay. After you integrate both sides, you kind of add this on both sides, okay, y of x of tf, okay, or y of tf basically, right, y is a function of h of x actually. So, that is why y is a function of x, so y of xf is what you want to multiply actually. So, add it actually. So, you have this constant equation after integration. And we add this expression y of x of tf to both sides. So, we add this. Now what you remember, take this one, this side by the way. This expression is taken that side. So, it is nothing but 0. So, 0 equal to that. Now, y of x tf is nothing but y of x tf plus that, whatever is that thing is there. So, in other words, this whole expression minus this expression coming this side. Yes. Now, add both sides, what you get is y of x of tf, okay, is nothing but this fellow, same thing, plus 0, and 0 is this one minus that one, entire thing here. Now, if you look at this expression, it contains integral of a derivative, and when you have something like this, and if you remember your calculus of variations a little bit, whenever expressions like this are there, we typically use integration by parts actually. So, we will do that here. So, this expression what you get here, we use this integration by parts, okay, to come up with this expression actually. And if you substitute this expression back in here, okay, what you get here is something like this. Okay, I suggest that you do it in pen and paper yourself, so that you will be much more convinced actually. Now, what happens? Okay. Now, we take this expression what you have, we take variations on both sides and try to combine terms actually. Okay. So, what you have to see here is take variations on that, y of tf, variations of first variation of that, and apply it on the right hand side and try combine terms and all that. Ultimately, you will end up with something like this. So, this is something like a little bit idea of calculus of variations coming into picture basically. Okay. Then you tell, okay, this we want it to be 0. Okay. This is our idea basically, because delta xf is something that we do not know. So, obviously, we want to make sure that this expression is independent of that. So, we make it 0. Then you tell, okay, initial condition is known perfectly. So, there is no variation of that. So, that has to go to 0. And by design, we also want to impose that this has to be 0. Okay. Then what happens? This first variation of ytf turns out to be just this one actually. Okay. And if you suppose we define this as b of t, then it turns out to be like this. Okay. And again, in general, it is not really recursive computation sort of thing. You can think of backward integration basically, that also you can call that as recursive. Okay. But it is not a discrete formulation. So, strictly speaking, there is nothing called recursive here actually. Okay. So, anyway, coming back to that, what you are getting here is by definition B of t is like this. Okay. So, B of t is by definition like that. W dot of t is this entire expression has to be 0, remember that. Okay. So, W dot of t is negative of that basically really. Okay. So, W dot of t is negative of that expression what you are getting here. Okay, so that will give us a differential equation to compute W of t using any numerical integration scheme, including fourth order Runge-Kutta method actually. But for integrating this, we also need a boundary condition, and then this boundary condition comes from there. Okay, remember, this is at t equal to tf. So, this boundary condition comes out from this actually. Okay. That means, using this boundary condition and this differential equation, we can quickly propagate it backwards from Tf to T0, and then we will get W of t everywhere. Once we get W of t everywhere, then B of t can be computed directly that way. All right, so I hope it is clear now. Now what happens here is, we got this expression, this is a constant equation again, and this constant equation we want to, we want to account for while minimizing this cost function actually. So that means, remember this is your updated control, So updated control means transpose times R times this updated control, that means we want the control minimization to happen actually. So this is the cost function that we want to optimize, minimize rather, subject to this constant equation that we are getting after imposing this actually. Once you impose this, this turns out to be like this, so this turns out to be the same constant equation actually. Now the procedure is fairly similar, you have to augmented cost function similar to calculus of variations also. So augmented cost function, and you tell my first differentiations and all has to be 0 basically. So you take about del jc bar by del of del u, then that turns out to be 0, and this del lambda, del jc bar by del lambda also needs to be equal to 0. That gives us the same boundary condition that we started with, which is compatible to standard results actually. Right, so if you do that and solve for this, we get something like this expression, like these three. Now if you substitute for delta u here, then you get some expression in terms of lambda, then you solve for lambda, once you solve for lambda you put it back and then tell this is my delta u t. Once you get delta u, you are done actually, because your control is, the updated control is nothing but u naught minus delta u basically that way. Alright, so u naught minus delta u is the control update, and that is delta u, you have just computed here, this expression, and that's what it turns out to be, where lambda is like this, lambda turns out to be like this. A lambda and B lambda are also defined that way, very very close to what we know in MPSV, but these are all continuous time expressions actually. Remember A lambda and B lambda were summations before, now it has become integrations actually, which is very compatible to what you know. Algorithm sense, it is similar, very similar again, but the only difference is we compute the weighting matrix by backward integration. It is, there is no recursive computation of sensitivity matrices, we call that as weighting matrix here, and then you compute the weighting matrix by backward integration and then update the control if necessary very quickly basically. Now usage of this particular in the same problem, let us revisit and see what all results you are getting, and as expected results will be fairly similar to what you got before actually. So this is the same problem that we talked in the previous lecture, tactical missile guidance with 3D impact angle constraint. And the motivation for that, why do you do and things like that have been discussed last lecture. So, I'm not going to talk about that again. Alright, so motivation again is something like, is it possible to achieve impact angle constraint in 3D simultaneously in some of 3D means azimuth and elevation both actually. Can you do that in some optimal manner basically that way? And can this terminal constraint in both the angles, that means azimuth angle which talks about direction of heading, and elevation angle which talks about pitch angle or something like top angle from the top and all that, can it be dictated, can it be told to the guidance logic actually? And then can the above objective be achieved for stationary targets or moving targets or maneuvering targets? All are ground target, but the target can be either stationary or just moving or maneuvering, and when it maneuvers it can have constant lateral acceleration, it can have time varying lateral acceleration, all sort of things actually. So these things, is it possible to do, that's what we are talking actually. Also we are telling, can this be achieved with minimum lateral acceleration demand? Recapitulate or revisit the challenges. First thing is, the system dynamics is nonlinear. And something like strong nonlinear coupling between elevation angle and azimuth angle has to be accounted for. You cannot think about decoupling them and just design at one at time sort of thing. And zero or near zero mesh distance is resolved, because without zero mesh distance, angle constraints have no meaning actually. Because unless you unless the vehicle falls on the target, what's the value of angles otherwise? So that's why it is extremely important here. 3D impact angle constraints are desired, essentially two angle constraints actually simultaneously, and lateral demand has to be minimum as possible throughout sort of thing. Also remember, this lateral acceleration history has some implication of what is called as induced drag actually. If the vehicle turns more, then the induced drag component turns out to be more also. So hence by minimizing the lateral acceleration, we minimize the induced drag component of it, and hence there is some range extension implication and all that actually. Okay, so the engagement scenario is very similar to what we had discussed in the last class. It starts with some sort of initial condition and finally falls with some target, and at that point of time there are two angle constraints. One is this angle, the other one is that angle actually. Essentially this angle turns out to be something like, if you extend this trajectory a little bit, and this angle is the negative gamma f, but this angle is same as the other side of negative gamma f actually. Okay. Alright, so that is how it is actually. So, system dynamics, very same what we discussed before, state vector, okay, v gamma psi and x, y, z, control variables are a, z, a, y, okay. And delays and all that is also been accounted for while evaluating the guidance law sort of thing. Target model is a ground target, so we have only x, y, so x dot and y dot is dictated by psi, and what psi dot is dictated by lateral acceleration that the target applies to itself actually. So, in some sense point mass model is assumed, measurement of coordinates are available, target velocity is constant, and things like that actually. So, these are somewhat realistic assumptions, but this can always be relaxed with some sort of estimation in the loop, which we are not talking here actually. And if the target is moving, it can do the following. That means it can simply continue to move in a straight line, no constant maneuver, no maneuver, but it just simply moves in a straight line. Otherwise it can also have constant g maneuvers, keeps on turning in a constant manner. Otherwise it can have sinusoidal maneuver as well actually, and a combination of that is also a possibility. Okay. Here what you are telling is, whatever the target does is kind of known to the guidance of the missile actually. Typically that turns out to be a hard problem also, and that is where estimation logics are important, and an estimation is supposed to give, target estimation rather, is supposed to give the required information to the guidance law actually. But anyway, coming back to that, this is the problem formulation. We have this final y, which is given in terms of gamma and psi, and in terms of x, y, z, they have to go to some desired values, y star basically. Okay. And the guess history is augmented pn, same thing as what you had shown in the last class. Sigma dot you compute first, and then this will have three components, sigma dot x, sigma dot y, sigma dot z. In terms of using this sigma dot x and sigma dot y, you can compute sigma dot p and sigma dot y. Okay, so this kind of thing. And then it turns out to okay, you can compute this vc as well. Okay. Using this expression, and then tell okay, my AZ and NY, AY can be computed something like this. So, more on that is available in standard literature anyway. Then you apply our newly developed continuous time MPSP, or rather generalized MPSP actually, then you get very similar results what you have shown before in the next lecture sort of. So, here you talk about initial condition being same, two angles, okay, but three different cases are there where your desired values of gamma and psi are different combinations actually. Okay. And this is the just three cases we are telling, but that is, it has been validated with a number of cases like this. It is much more number of cases, arbitrarily selected values like that actually, that way. Okay, now if you see that, no matter whatever angle constraints you put, you are able to go there, meet there actually. Okay, now 3D sense it may not be so easy to see, but that's why you have plotted this image plots and all that. One image plot is in terms of z and x, this is the image plane, and one in terms of x and y. So that's the image plane actually. there is also somewhat clear how the angles are developing, but if you really want a particular clear value of representation and all that, you can always plot in 2D and see. Anyway, guidance commands turns out to be like this, and you can see that the lateral acceleration demand is not really very much. Say about 6g, I mean within 6g here, and something like within 3g here, and here also if you see minus 3.2g maximum value, and these are very much achievable in a good missile actually. So the lateral acceleration demand turns out to be very much alright. And also you can see there are not too much of fluctuations on the way, it just kind of develops very smoothly. Okay, initially there is some sort of a small rapid development, but later onwards it remains somewhat fairly smooth. Okay, so this kind of a lateral acceleration is very good, because inner loops can track this histories very well actually. Okay. All right, so now we can see from trajectories, okay, for a different initial condition but same final condition. Okay, final condition is required same, but the initial condition can be different. Okay, so that is what it happens, again it is able to meet it no matter whatever is our initial condition. Okay, now if you really see whether it is happening or not happening, you can actually plot these angle values, okay, how they are developing. Tell at the end all these are meeting at the same values, minus 20 degree, and all these are meeting at the same values, plus 20 degree, and that is what we wanted, minus 20 and plus 20. So that gives us a validation of what is happening in a clear way basically. Yeah. Okay. Now if you take stationary targets again, but perturbation of initial conditions, what happens, this is what you are talking about. And what happens in terms of lateral acceleration, you can see AZ and AY, again it is within some minus 9.5 g sort of thing, and here also it is 4 g maximum, or maybe 5 g here if you look at it actually. Now remember, this missiles are typically their lateral acceleration constraints are typically of the order of 10 g, 15 g like that actually. Okay, so this numbers what you see here, what you are looking at here, is very much within the capability. Right. Now, how does it compare with respect to APN, okay, that augmented PN? Remember, the augmented PN is the one which serves as the gas history irrespective of whatever conditions we want to put, that is kind of a default gas history actually. Then you can tell, okay, if I take gamma naught and psi naught as 0, 20, okay, but I want this particular values minus 80 and 20, then what is the, how can it come, I mean how does it compare? You can see one is doesn't talk about angle constraint, so it goes its own way, but it finally meets at the position. But the other one not only meets it, but it also satisfies the angle constraint actually. Basically, so the trajectory shaping happens. So that the final angle constraints are met actually. So you can again see this angles gamma and psi m. In one case, they are very far off from what you desire. The solid line, okay, is what you ultimately want. Okay. This dotted line is what happens in APN, if there are some waving behavior, ultimately the point is it is too far away from what you require. What you require is almost vertical impact, that means minus 80 degree with 20 degree azimuth angle constraint. Okay. So this is what the 20 degree you can see, the black line sort of thing, solid line. So that is the difference. If yes, not only you get it there, but you get it there in a very smooth way sort of thing. And this is another plot which tells us that, okay, if the target does either straight line or a constant turning or a sinusoidal behavior, okay, then can I do that? Answer is yes. Each of the cases you are able to engage with the target. But also remember, here you are assuming that this behavior of the target is actually known from our good estimation logic, which we are not discussing here. Okay, so any misdistance in this particular cases will turn out to be there is a large contribution from the estimation loop, really, it is not with respect to the guidance loop actually. That validation is being shown here in these pictures. Alright, so this is also, you can see number wise, the final numbers are here, okay, one case minus 20, other case minus 40, other case minus 60, and here it is minus 20, so minus 30 and minus 40 basically, everything is met. That is what here. And interestingly, there is another comparison which talks about comparison with something called zero effort miss plot. And you can see the zero effort miss for APN is very wavy, and ultimately it goes to zero. But MPSP ZDM turns out to be much more smoother on the throughout actually, and that's a good sign of a good guidance law. So, concluding remarks of GMPSP. This generalized MPSP formulation discretization of the system dynamics is not required. Okay, and any higher order technique can be used, and one standard thing can be thought about is fourth order Rugge-Kutta scheme, which is very standard in integrating numerically the differential equations actually. So, if you think about putting that, you can simply put it. If you want different integration scheme other than Rugge-Kutta method, that also you are welcome to do that actually. And it also turns out that MPSP is a special case of generalized MPSP, and those things I am not going to discuss here. And then we have actually applied this to a 3D impact angle guidance constant guidance problem. It has been kind of solved using this technique actually. Results are pretty similar to MPSP results, and sometimes some superior results also have been seen. Okay, result is similar or superior because suddenly the discretization is not there from the beginning. So, the accuracy level is very good from the beginning itself actually. And then sometimes it is little bit superior to MPSP, but many times it is superior to PN guidance law, and that is both for regular MPSP or GMPSP actually. Okay, because what you are telling here is you are making use of this benefits of nonlinear optimal control theory actually. That's why the results are much superior, okay, as compared to the augmented PN law. All right, so that's what I wanted to discuss in this particular lecture. Thank you.